And then church, and no matter who you are or where you are or where you may be joining us from today, you are welcome here. A few quick announcements. First is that Pastor Kurt and I both were on vacation last week, so we might be a little out of practice. Bear with us this morning. Just kidding. Yeah, Suzanne's very happy. I'd like to quickly thank Deb Carpenter for stepping into the tech role with Suzanne today. We unannounced did not sign up, and everybody assumed Emily'd be back with me, but Emily's still with friends camping elsewhere, and so Deb stepped right up this morning 5 minutes before the service. So thank you, Deb. The focus group in town is looking for nominees for the Sherburne Award. The Sherburne Award recognizes outstanding contributions made by a Deerfield resident serving our community. And you can email nominations. The email address is perch59@msn.com or contact Joanne at 463-9848 if you have someone in mind for that award. The Red Cross is gonna have a blood drive here on Thursday the 22nd. From 2 to 6:30, as always, it's best to call ahead and get an appointment. A lot of times, especially post-COVID, they are not necessarily welcoming walk-ins just because of protocols, et cetera. So do give them a call. The information is in the EDCC. And I think the rest are far enough out or things that you can read in the EDCC your own. Evelyn. Okay, so Aging with Grace. Got it. Okay, so Aging with Grace is now on Mondays at 10:30 and via Zoom. And if you are not currently a member but want to join them, they'd love to have more members, more people joining them. You don't have to be old. We're all aging. So they'd love to have you. Lynn. So Deerfield Historical Society having a spring bulb sale, and Lynn has info in the great room. And if you're on Zoom, you can call Lynn and I'm sure she'll take your order right over the phone. So Andy, I didn't warn you about this, but can we cue up happy birthday this morning? Is that possible? It is Suzanne's birthday. And if anybody deserves happy birthday, it is Suzanne after the last 2 years. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Suzanne. Happy birthday to you. Right. And I think the only other announcement that just popped into my head is the regathering team. We were supposed to meet after worship today. Cindy is out not feeling well this morning. So we are going to postpone that, I think, until Tuesday on the regathering team, and wondering where everybody is for the meeting. Going to happen on Tuesday via Zoom. So with that, let us now breathe in deeply. Focus ourselves and center ourselves in a time of worship and welcome the light of Christ among us. And would you please stand, and as you are able, and join in singing our opening hymn number 417. 417, this is a day of new beginnings.
This is a day of new beginnings, time to remember and move on, time to believe what love is bringing, lay to rest the pain that's gone. For by the life and death of Jesus, God's mighty Spirit now as then can make for us the world of difference. Matters and hope are born again. Then let us with the Spirit's daring step from the past and leave behind our disappointment, guilt, and grieving, seeking new paths and sure to find. Christ is alive and goes before us to show and share what love can do. This is a day of new beginnings. Our God is making all things new. In faith we'll gather round the table to taste and share what love can do. This is a day.
Please remain standing and join me in this morning's call to worship. Come, passion and joy of King David and all the people who sang and danced before the Ark of the Covenant.
Let us worship our Savior with the songs of praise and thanksgiving of the Apostle Paul and all who are blessed
with every spiritual blessing. God has blessed us in our Lord Jesus Christ, destined us to be children of God, and sealed us in the Holy Spirit. Let us
worship God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
We now come to the time of prayer in this community of faith. It is a time in which we give ourselves the opportunity to raise up in voice or in silence those prayers that we wish to raise to God amidst God's people. I have a few this morning, and then we'll open it up for others who wish to share their prayers. Tim, thank you so much for running around. And
you're welcome.
Yes, and don't touch the microphone. Tim does not like it when you touch the microphone.
Someday we'll get back to where you can touch the microphone.
Prayers that I have this morning. Carol Hutchinson requests prayers for her friend Betty, who lives in Warner, New Hampshire, following. Please pray for Betty. She also requests prayers for those search teams in Surfside, Florida. I'm sure those of you who have seen the news over the last few weeks, there's still many bodies to find, and these search teams will be working for weeks to collect those bodies and so that they might have a proper burial. Please continue to pray for them and the families of those who are still missing. Please pray for them as well. And pray for those folks who are living in condominium buildings that were built exactly the same way, with the same specifications by the same construction company. So Miami-Dade County Courthouse had to close yesterday because they have repairs that have not been done, and the courthouse is in fear of falling down. So pray for all of those folks, and pray for our society and the ways in which we cut corners to save costs and help us to ask, at what cost do we save costs? Bob Spindell requests prayers for people to come back to Deerfield Community Church and resume their faith journey. Bob, thank you so much for raising that prayer up. Noreen Dubianski requests continuous prayers for her upcoming appointments with specialists. Please continue to keep Noreen in your prayers. And Faith Barry requests continued prayers for her nephew, Josh. Those are the prayers of concern and celebration I have this morning. Are there any others?
I have one.
Yes.
And then I'll walk around with a mic.
Yeah.
I noticed this week that our neighbors down the street have a sign up that is welcoming their new pastor.
And
so
nice.
Let's raise prayers for who are going through something very similar to what we've gone through in the last couple months, and prayers that his ministry and their time together is as fruitful as ours is with Pastor Kurt.
Yeah. All right. That's a good opportunity for me to go visit. Not on Sunday morning.
I have two. I would like to ask for prayers for our friend Joel Kirby and his wife, Rachel. They are missionaries in South Africa, and Joel is very, very ill with COVID, has been for about a month, and he just needs prayers. And I also would like prayers for our friend Bob, who is nearing the end of his life.
Sue, could you just say that again? Are there missionaries in South Africa? Thank you. And Bob, what was the... Just Bob. Prayers for Bob. Thank you.
I have a prayer of joy. Yesterday, my brother and my two sisters and myself had a family reunion that was overdue for about a year and a half due to COVID. And we all got together, and that was my joy. That's my joy.
Nice. Thank you.
Prayers for our son-in-law, Danny, who is facing foot surgery on both feet, and he'll be on crutches for 2 months, non-weight bearing.
Did you say Danny?
I have a prayer of prayer for a friend of mine who he and his husband both are going through cancer treatments. Same type of cancer, so Stan and Alan. And then I have a prayer of gratitude for all of you. Thank you for being such an important part of my life and giving me joy and support and love.
Thank you, Suzanne. And those two names were? Stan and Alan.
I ask for prayers for the people of Haiti who are going through a time of just horrible increased turmoil.
Yes. Thank you, Jackie.
Continued prayers for Steve Pominville, who is continuing to have seizures, and Mike.
Thank you, Ellen.
Prayers for Don, who will be hopefully having his shot this week on the knee, a cortisone shot, and that it will help. And prayers for my sister's friend, Eddie, who passed away suddenly.
Continue prayers for Joe Dubianski, please.
A prayer of thanksgiving for the man who came last Monday and replaced the shingles on the roof so that our roof doesn't leak anymore.
Nice. Thank you, Robbie. That's good news. I didn't know that. That's good. Seeing no other prayers of concern and celebration, let us pray together. Holy Abba of our Lord Jesus Christ, who sends the Holy Spirit to help us in our praying, open our senses to your creation and our hearts to the needs of others. Grant us faith, hope, and imagination to see your vision of the fullness of time when weapons will be crushed by peace, stomachs will be filled by abundant harvests, generously shared, and thirsts quenched by pure rain falling from clean skies. Diseases will be healed, minds made clear, bodies made new, so that all things reveal oneness in you. Even now, God, empower us by the Spirit to serve Christ in love by sharing your vision and working in the world for which Christ died and rose and prays and is coming to complete in resurrection. We pray these things in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Grant us wisdom to perceive you, hearts awaken to receive you, minds alert to thoughts that grieve you, God of mercy, hear us.
You can touch it. You're the strangest looking Cindy Bradley I've ever seen, though.
Good morning. Good morning. The gifts you give today help the ministries and missions of the church. This morning's offering will be taken and received.
I'll get that.
Because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted, you were condemned, and I'm alive and well, your Spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be? My King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. And I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted, you were condemned, I'm alive and well, your Spirit is within me, because because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be you, my king, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. Amazing love, how can it be you, my king, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you. Amazing love, how can it be you, my king, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you. Please join me in reciting the prayer of dedication.
Thank you for filling us with every spiritual grace that we might be a blessing for others. Consecrate the gifts we offer for the increase of your love. May they bring blessing to others and praise to your glorious name. Amen.
Welcome our young and young at heart forward, and we will sing together verse 1 of hymn number 325, Child of Blessing, Child of Promise.
Child of blessing, child of promise, baptized with the Spirit's sign. With this water, God has sealed you unto love and grace divine.
I love when there's not enough room.
All right, good morning. I thought you were leaving entirely. Well, good morning. How are you all this morning? I think this is the first time I've had my dad up here. How exciting. I know it's because you were already up here. Your vacation carried over, so you're still feeling young at heart from your trip. So this morning, I wanted to talk to you about all the wonderful ways that you are treated by God, by Jesus, by the Lord. What are some ways that you feel treated? It's kind of a weird question. When you think of people in your life, you think of how do they treat me sometimes? You think, you know, maybe, oh, I had this really nice teacher who, you know, treated me so kindly, or I had this neighbor who treated me, you know, really generously. When you think about how you're treated by God, what do you think of? We did get a lot of rain lately when we really needed it. That was very generous, right? I was tired of watering my garden. So it was a great blessing to me because I'm not really a gardener. And I've bitten off more than I can chew this year, if I'm being honest. And so yes, that rain was such a gift. So it was a very generous, yeah. Yeah, never gives up on us, right? Faithfulness to us. Right? So God's never going to give up on you because of his love. Anything else? How do you feel treated? Yeah.
He gives us lots of things to see that remind us that he's there.
Lots of things to see. So like God sightings, right? So we... So lots of nature things, sunrise and your dogs and the flowers and the trees, all these things to remind us that God is near. Yeah. Yep. So all these little ways that you're maybe feeling that love over and over. So something that a way that I feel treated is loved and cared for and sometimes encouraged. I'll feel really kind of blah about something, you know, and I might feel encouraged by, you know, through prayer or something, I might have this feeling of encouragement. And I love when I have something to talk about and I realize that I have the perfect t-shirt for that day. And so this t-shirt I wore quite deliberately today, and I made this just to give myself a little pat on the back. And it says, "You are capable, loved, worthy, important, kind, and strong." And these are all ways that God might make you feel important. So I want you to take all those feelings that you get from God and put them in your pocket and keep them real close to you. But also, they're going to multiply while they're hanging out there in your pocket close to you. So then you're going to take them out and pass them out to other people. So if you feel encouraged, you're going to keep that close to you and let it multiply and just be in your heart. And then you're going to pass that feeling of encouragement out to other people. Because all those feelings you take in, I want you to turn around and give them back to other people. Because if God can give us all this great stuff, surely we can also give back to other people those really great things too. So I hope you feel great and encouraged and loved and blessed and all of those things. And then give it out. All right? So let's be in prayer. Lord, all these amazing, fantastic ways you make us feel. The way you treat us is incomparable. But let's not just absorb those great feelings into ourselves. Let's multiply them and pass them out to everybody in our paths so that they can feel those great feelings too. Amen.
Speaking of God sightings, the flowers this morning are absolutely beautiful, and they were given in memory of Diane Shore's and Chris Shore's mother this morning by Diane and Chris. So, yes, your father. Suzanne gave me the wrong parent. So their father's birthday.
Good morning once again.
Good morning.
Today's first reading
is a quick one. Very short. However, it's loaded with information for you to absorb and use. Reading is from Psalm 63, verse 3 and 4. Because of your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands and call on your name. May God bless the reading of this verse.
This morning's second reading comes from the second book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 5, verses 16 through 20. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, In Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us, we entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. This week's love song, which as soon as I heard Walt sing, I know I'm, you know, I don't like to call people out in the congregation because sometimes it embarrasses them, but Walt, I just feel like I don't have to preach today. So thank you. Thank you. And that's the beauty of doing these kinds of sermon series, is it's like, it takes a little pressure off the pastor. It's like, well, you know, if the sermon falls flat on its face, the song is great, you know? And also to Jennifer, right? Like, well, if the sermon falls on its face, Jennifer's message was spot on. I'm glad I come third, you know? This week's love song is Amazing Love. I didn't know this song. Jessica knew this song. And those who have come from other different, maybe faith backgrounds within Christianity have heard this song a lot. And I had not. The song Amazing Love was written and first performed in 2002 by Hillsong, which I did know about that group. That's a pretty big group within praise song circles. And the song has to do with the subject or an explanation of, I bet you didn't know this, God's amazing love for us through the act of the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus. Did you get that when Walt was singing that? No? So the chorus, amazing love, how can it be that you, my king, should die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do to honor you. It is a song about what theologians, so I should pause here for a second and say that what I'm about to do is explain to you atonement theory. Now, I know most of you, your eyes just went like this, and you were just like, really? You know? But I promise you it won't be too painful because I'm not going to do justice to any of these theories of atonement. I'm just giving you a little bit a hint of what atonement is, what it means, and how it relates to our faith tradition. And I'm going to do that in like 2 minutes, which all of my theologian mentors in seminary would just be horrified. So we'll probably end up doing a Bible study on this at some point too. But this is just a little flavor. This is a song about what theologians refer to as atonement. An atonement is a fancy seminary word that simply means an act of repairing or reconciling after an offense or injury has occurred. So it's making things right, right? Within the context of Jesus' death, the word atonement is used to describe what it is to God, namely us, as a result of Jesus' death and resurrection. Another way of thinking about this word, and I didn't hear this until I was in seminary, but this kind of boils it down. Another way of thinking about the word atonement is to break down the word itself. At-One-Ment. At-One-Ment. Or unification with God, i.e. salvation. Where is it that we go after life, and how do we get there? Specifically, atonement is like, how do we get to heaven? How do we get to be one with God? Not just to hang out with God, but to actually be one with God at one moment. Amen. So how is it that we, humanity, might become one with God? The song Amazing Grace makes reference to a particular kind of atonement called substitutionary atonement. Now, throughout history of Christianity, there has been much written about and spoken of and preached on about atonement. And as I mentioned, there are many accepted theories of atonement, and there are literally libraries full of books espousing each one of these theories. So for the sake of brevity, I'll highlight three of these theories, and no doubt will, as I mentioned, I will do none of them any justice whatsoever. Yes, and I hope that all of your heads don't explode. Yes, yes. So for the first half, so we'll cut to the chase, right? So for the first 1,000 years of Christianity, for the first half of Christianity's existence, approximately 1,000 years, the prevailing view was ransom atonement. Now, this is kind of a trippy thing because people like Augustine, Augustine, depends on where you grew up and how you pronounce it, or Oregon, right? These are really, really big early church people who wrote a ton about all sorts of things about Christianity. And all of these folks all believed in this theory, which is kind of a trip because I'm about to explain it to you. This is what pretty much everybody thought for the first 1,000 years of Christianity. This theory believed that the death of Jesus was a ransom sacrifice that was paid to Satan in exchange for releasing humans from the bondage of our inherited sin. So, Satan had control over humanity since the fall of man, and only the soul of perfectly innocent Jesus would be an acceptable payment for the return of humanity to God. Now keep in mind, this is payment that God, apparently, had to pay to Satan. Like God owed Satan something. Okay? Right? That kind of, right? Right? But unbeknownst to the devil, and I like this, because this really, at the heart of all theories, is like a little twist. It's like, well, sure, that's why it's a theory, right? So the twist in this one is, little known to the devil, Jesus was also God. Aha! Right? So Jesus goes into hell. Satan says, thank you. Jesus says, oh boy, do I have a surprise for you. Leaves hell with everybody else, empties the gates, right, and goes to heaven and is one with God and everybody else forever. That was ransom atonement. Then the two primary, or majority, I should say, majority in this country that I'm aware of, theories of atonement that we have today are substitutionary atonement and nonviolent atonement. Now, substitutionary atonement was brought forth by a gentleman by the name of Saint Anselm in 1099, who first believed that it was basically impossible for God to owe Satan anything, right? I'm down with that, right? Holds that Jesus Christ redeemed humanity through making himself a more, and this is more than he needed to, making himself a sacrifice, but in a way that was more than was actually required of him, sacrifice as satisfaction to God, rather than Satan, to God, for humanity's having dishonored God through our disobedience in the garden. Okay? Got that? Kinda? Hold on, right? It is by Jesus's own, and this is important because this is kind of the key to this. It is by Jesus's superfluous sacrifice, more than what was actually asked of him or required of him. Okay? Obedience to satisfy our debt that we are saved. It is by that sacrifice, partially required by God, partially Jesus saying, No, I'm going above and beyond, okay? In other words, the debt is total, the obligation to pay it is total, and the power to pay it, from our standpoint, is zero. The answer then is found in the sacrifice of Christ. Fully human, he can atone for man. Fully God, he can restore God's honor. This is substitutionary atonement, that God sacrificed God's self to save us. And finally, over the last 50 years or so, there has been another theory of atonement that has been taking hold within Christianity, mostly in the Western Hemisphere. The theory is rooted in the philosophical concept of the scapegoat. Right? You familiar with the scapegoat? The idea of the scapegoat? The idea that you kill a goat, and your harvest will be abundant, right? You sacrifice something, right? And we've seen this play itself out throughout human history, right? So in this theory of atonement, Jesus Christ dies as the scapegoat of humanity. This theory moves away from the idea that Jesus died in order to act upon God or as payment to the devil. Scapegoating, therefore, is considered to be a form of nonviolent atonement on the part of God, in that Jesus is not a sacrifice, but a victim. And there are many philosophical concepts that are raised within this model, but in the general sense, we can say that Jesus Christ is the scapegoat, meaning the following. This is a simple way of thinking about this. Jesus is killed by a violent crowd. The violent crowd kills him, believing that he is guilty. Through the resurrection, Jesus is proven innocent by God as the true Son of God. The crowd is therefore deemed guilty. Now, one of the main differing points here is that nonviolent atonement theory removes God as the perpetrator of the violence or the entity in need of the violence to, and rather makes God the redeemer of his son from the true perpetrator of the violence, namely us. So all of these theories of atonement have and will forever continue to be proof text in scripture forever and ever and ever. Long after our great, 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 great grandchildren have passed away. The point I'm trying to make this morning is this. Here's my point. So if you haven't listened, here's my point. So the point I'm trying to make this morning is this. It may not matter to you which atonement theory you believe in personally. It may not matter to you. And I will tell you, though, that whichever theory of atonement we choose to have as our own, it will play itself out in other ways in our life, regardless of how much we are aware of it or not. It changes our worldview, our understanding of love, of victims, of grace, mercy, forgiveness, hope, and joy. What really matters regarding our idea of how it is that we are saved, that we are at one with God, or will be at one with God. What really matters is what is in each of our hearts and how that atonement plays itself out in our interactions with others. And this is what Paul was saying to the Corinthians. So, regardless of what you believe concerning the crucifixion, regardless of what redeeming act ought to be highlighted in the life and death of Jesus, whether it be the crucifixion or the resurrection, as a sign of God's amazing love for us, the point here is that God's love for us truly is amazing. God's love for us is more merciful and gracious than we could ever possibly imagine. Not only having bestowed upon all of creation, but maybe most specifically, depending on how you're feeling that particular day, how gracious it is and merciful it is that God loves me, that God loves each of you. Right? That is amazing love. God loves us, not just so we can be reminded of how precious and worthy we are, but how precious and worthy other people are too. Regardless of what our opinion may be of them on a particular day, regardless of how we might feel about them as being a member of our blood family, right? Or friend or neighbor, right? God's amazing love for us through Christ is so that we might then, as Jennifer said as well, we might then take that love, amazing love, that we receive and send it out into the world through our hands and our feet and our mouths and our eyes and our ears. Right? That's how we can love. We can love in amazing ways. We have the ability to do so, because we have first been given that amazing love by God through Christ. Amen? Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now, I bless you all, and I pray that you forget all of the things that I said about atonement. And just remember God's amazing love for us, that we might share it with others.
As we prepare this morning for our time of communion, we're going to sing together hymn number 207, Just As I Am.
Just as I am, without one plea, but that your blood was shed for me, O Lamb of God, I come.
So on this particular Sunday, with this particular subject and this particular song, I will say to you that that song is substitutionary atonement. It is a beautiful song, and it is about the sacrifice of Christ for us. How that was done, I will never know. It is a mystery that is held by God and God alone. But one of the beautiful things that we get to do in this tradition is that we get to remember that sacrifice, not just to the point of the resurrection or the crucifixion, through the resurrection to this point at this table, when we do visibly, symbolically remember Christ by becoming one with Christ through the bread and the cup. How can we, I, any of us, any committee, council, congregation, congressional edict, denominational writ, cardinal, how could any human entity ever stand between anybody and that kind of amazing love that comes from only one place, from God? So I always like the invitation because it gives me an opportunity to remind us all that the invitation is in and of itself superfluous. How dare I invite anybody to this table when I know that they know nobody needs an invitation to this table today because they had been invited, everybody has been invited to this table since the beginning of time. Truly, in this moment, at this table, this is a visible act of our believing and saying every Sunday morning, no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. So, please pray with me the unison prayer of communion prayer that you have listed, hopefully. Yes? Holy God of all, you call us before your table to be your beloved children and to care for one another. Yet we fail to love others and ourselves as fully as you love us. Helpless and humbled, we turn our hearts and minds to the gracious hospitality you show all who come to your table in remembrance of your Son. Forgive us, we pray, and tenderly teach us to stand strong and courageous for those who have been turned away from this meal. In the fullness of your love, by the grace and mercy of your Son, our sibling Christ Jesus. Amen. Siblings in Christ, according to the riches of God's grace, as visibly experienced at this table, and which God has lavished upon us and sealed for us by the promised Holy Spirit, hear this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he first gave his friends thanks, and he held the bread up for all to see. And he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Every time you take of this bread, do so in remembrance of me." And after the meal was over, he again gave his friends thanks, and he held the cup up for all to see, and he poured it out. And he said, "This is my blood poured out for you. It is a cup of a new covenant, a cup of God's grace and mercy and love and forgiveness. And it is not just poured out for you, but it is poured out for your children and your grandchildren. Every time you take this drink, do so in remembrance of me." The bread of life, take and eat. And the cup of salvation, take and drink. Well, that's interesting. See how God's blessings work so instantly? It's amazing. So I noticed that I have the sending music after the benediction. Do I usually do that? I don't think I usually do that. Could we do the singing first and then I do the benediction?
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
They don't know. They don't have a bulletin.
That's true. That's true. So we're going to sit. So please stand as you are able and join me in singing. Suzanne, is that okay? I know your job is hard enough, and I thank you so much for doing it with grace and mercy. And yes, thank you so much. Okay.
So our opening hymn number four, or closing hymn, yes, number 495, Called as Partners in Christ Service.
Yes.
Called as partners in Christ's service, called to ministries of grace, we respond with deep commitment, fresh new lines of faith to trace. May we learn the art of sharing side by side and friend with friend. Christ's example, Christ inspiring, Christ's clear call to work and worth. Let us follow, never faltering, reconciling folk on earth. Men and women, richer, poorer, all God's people, young and old, blending human skills to from God unfold. Thus new patterns for Christ's mission in a small or global sense help us bear each other's burdens, breaking down each wall or fence. Words of comfort, words of vision, words of challenge said with care, bringing power and through action, makes us colleagues free and fair. So God grant us for tomorrow ways to order human life that surround each person's sorrow with a calm that conquers strife. Make us partners in our living, our compassion to increase. Messengers of faith, us giving hope and confidence and peace.
Siblings in Christ, go forth in amazing love so that you might give that amazing love to others. Amen.
Amen. Bo, you're up.
Beau doesn't have a bulletin either.
There it is.